Okay. Good morning again. We are back with the following talk. It's completely different angle. It's rear mass deployment. You can find, I will put also the presentation here, but you can also find the demonstration that I will give on this GitHub page. All right. It's a bit strange. It's a story about, let me explain. About 35K. What do I mean with 35K? 35,000 systems. And make rear happen for 35,000 systems. Not an easy task. Okay, continue. This is a poll that we had in 2015, about how is rear used. And let's say almost 50% of the answers that came back were about internal backups. So that means that they were using backup NetFS and the location was more or less on an S server or NFS or whatever. And you can also see there are some open source backup. This here, it's quite a lot. Probably barriers. Mike is hoping it. And there's some other things. You see cloud backups. It's not that maybe 5 years later it can be different a bit, but on the customers that I know and that I work with and who are using rear, they're also still using internal backup schemes. Okay, that was a side kick. Now, if you talk about rear, you have to talk about the cloud also. An in-house cloud and also the outside cloud. You have the Amazon, Azure, Google. There's a lot of vSphere VMs, physical servers, and even the older physical Linux systems. SUSE 10, for example, which are not officially supported anymore. Just as an example, I think 2 weeks ago I was called to help in assistance and do a disaster recovery, which was failing on a very old physical system with a rear 1.14. I couldn't even remember when that was released. But okay, finally it worked. So these are the questions that you have. If you are talking about rear mass deployment, where is it required and where it is not required? Okay, this is the question effect, to rear or not to rear. This is the question that I hear all the time if I come to customers. We don't need rear. After a couple of months, they come back. We need rear because we had a serious disaster and our cloud system could not resolve it. Okay. Then I come along and they say, okay, we make snapshots. This is regular the situation within the cloud environment. Amazon makes daily snapshots and you can recover it. It's not an easy task to do that. It's a pain in the thing. Azure, I never worked with it personally, but it is more or less the same. So also with vSphere, virtual machines, they take snapshots. If they're using some commercial backups solutions, that is a possibility, then say they don't need rear. Eventually, the customer that I wrote this mass deployment schema for came back to me and said, yeah, we want rear, even if they're taking snapshots. So, okay, they're changing the mind very often. If something very bad happens and they can't resolve it, via snapshot because they lost something very seriously and the customer is pissed off because the complete warehouse is down. It's a balance that you have to take. You have to think very carefully about this question. It's not a stupid question, to rear or not to rear. It's very easy said, we don't want rear because we have snapshots, we have very good backup schemas and it works fine, but eventually something goes wrong, always. Okay. I don't have to convince you. If you want to do a mass deployment of rear, automation is the key, of course. And there are some very good software for it. You have Ansible, you have Chef, you have Puppet, and some other tools, Salt, I may not forget these days. So they asked me to write a cookbook. They're using Chef at that company. So I use Chef daily, so I know Chef quite well. I also use Ansible quite a lot. At home, so every deployment I do at home is written in Ansible from A to Z. I gave several demos with Barius, for example. The complete system setup and Barius automation backup is all done with Ansible, so everything is possible there. But you can do the same with Ceph and even with Pipette. So if you want to move mass deployment, you have to be able to install Rear, to configure Rear, even to unconfigure it. If you decide we don't want it anymore, you have to be able to remove the configuration files. And to remove it is also a possibility. And you have to work with attributes. I come back to that. Attributes give you the possibility to define everything without touching the cookbook itself. I wrote a Rear cookbook, which is available already. It's not 100% finished. When it's 100% finished and the 35,000 systems are working fine and proven to be working fine, I will push it to the supermarket of Ceph, and then it's available for the world. It's already available for the world, but you have to know the location, of course. For the moment, it's only tested on RHEL, the CentOS 6, 7, and 8, but okay, it is Rear, so it means that it works on all other flavors of Linux systems. The only thing that is not covered yet is inside the cookbook. The commands are maybe different, but Ceph is clever enough. If you know Ceph, you can make the configurations, definitions, or your recipes that they are equal on all the OSs, in fact. So I don't have to change much, I think. And it also recognizes older Rear versions, which are still more or less supported, 1.17, 2.0, and Rear 2.4. Why is that? That's not a stupid number. That's coming from the RHEL community. So they are still supporting those three levels of Rear versions. So it's covered in there as well. The attributes, I come back to it. I don't know if you can read it quite well, but it's in fact a translation of your local configuration file. Okay? And you can overrule it. You have, for example, the Rear cookbook, which will be in the supermarket. If you want to overrule with your own settings, you don't have to rewrite this cookbook. The attributes give you the ability to redefine these variables in your own cookbook. And that's the nice thing about it, with attributes. So you don't have to touch the cookbook. You can just add it somewhere else, and it will be using your variables and just instead of these default ones. Okay. For that customer, the backup URL, yeah, because they are global, and they have a lot of NetApp systems where they were pushing their Rear images because they were using NFS and the Rear ISO image, and even the backup is going to NAS. I think they have maybe 20 different locations where they put stuff. They have a file, and I call this file the etc install config file, where they define the location and some other variables. So we would be able to read that file and use the definition which is set in there. If it's empty, then of course, Rear configuration will not be configured because you don't want Rear to work. Okay, that's for example in Azure the case for the moment, but okay. If there's something else which doesn't make sense, the configuration will detect it and will use sane values. Okay, there's an attribute for it, which is the default, that's way of saying. Okay. I will demonstrate this cookbook now with Kitchen. Kitchen is something that's also an open source community that can drive your tests with Puppet, Chef, Ansible, and other stuff. And it uses Vagrant and some Vagrant boxes to underneath to work with it. So you can find everything with Kitchen over there. And there's a Kitchen YAML file which defines effect the tests or the setup that I want. It looks like this. Just have a look at the GitHub pages and you can see it. You can define everything that you want. You can, I'm using here Vagrant, but you can use any kind of driver effect. You can use different kinds of provisioners, OSs, and then some other stuff that you want or require. And as last, you have a run list. This is effect when we talk about Rear, the recipe that we want to execute. Okay, I will give some demos. The first demo will be with a configuration file installed, and this is the default value. That's something, because my Mac is in fact the LFS of Nest server. And the virtual box is in fact the client. So that is one of the 35,000, by way of speaking, that needs a configuration. I will deploy the configuration through Kitchen, and Kitchen will call automatically Chef to deploy rear, etc. Then the second demo, I will just edit the config file here and put NA or empty, doesn't matter. Then it says, okay, you don't want rear, and see what happens. And you can just delete it, and you see what the default value will be. Okay. And finally, there is also, this is Chef, in fact, and part of Chef is also another project, Inspec. And with Inspec, it's a very nice tool, and you can define every test that you want, verification test, for example. I use this tool, not daily, but very often at the customers, to inspect systems before and after patching, for example, to see what changed. And also use it a lot with security settings. So you can really scan your 35,000 systems and see if there are any vulnerability in there with Kitchen, with Inspect, in fact. Very good tool. It's open source, by the way. Okay, I think this is the end of the of the slides. I'll go back for the presentation. Okay. If I do Kitchen lists, I already did a Kitchen create, and the Kitchen create will in fact create a virtual scene. Nothing more than that, in fact. It's just a pure CentOS 7 system. I did not do any special configuration. It is already created, but I have done nothing with it. So what I will do now is Kitchen converge, because that's the command that will run the recipe of rear. It will take a few moments to kick off. So it will log in into the vagrant box, and it will start. It will first download the Chef stuff, because I've defined it with Chef, and then it will run the cookbook. And now it fails. So why? Well, I can look at that here. Python. I can't install. Can't install. Download Chef. Okay, that's a pity. Let's log in for a second. Do I have an IP address? Do I have an IP address?
Do you have a default gateway?
Hmm? It should be. It's going to there. That's a pity, it should work here. Ah, come on. So that's also the problem with live systems, huh? Ah, of course it's Mac. It should be working, but it is working, of course. I don't know why it fails. What did it say? You need to download. Destination reasonable. Yeah, I'm getting. That's a pity. It can't download Chef, so that's a problem. I should have downloaded that one first, but okay, doesn't matter. Ping. What did it say? It's pointing to the tenant says.
Do you have an IPv4 address on the host?
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah, I should have it. That's good, huh?
So if you change the Wi-Fi,
yeah.
Then it will stack basically.
Yeah.
Because
yeah. There's no IPv4. Yeah. Okay. Still have time. All right. Yeah, now we have an IP address. Yes. All right. We can restart the demo. So again, it will log in into the vagrant box. As we have seen with the failure, it will try to download Chef, and then it will run the recipe. Okay, now it's trying to download it. Yes, it's a lot of traffic on FOSDEM network, of course. But the nice thing, the following demonstrations will be faster for the simple reason because Chef is already there, so it doesn't need to download it. So the first time is always the slowest one. But I want to start the demonstration with an empty system so that you can really see how it is working. And this is driven with kitchen effect, okay? Yes?
Well, maybe you can tell us something about the project, the industry, the kind of devices you are saving. Completely secret.
Secret?
No, I'm just asking. What
no,
you
know. Really, it's not a
I'm
secret.
Curious. Now, about the project with the 35K devices, what kind of industry is it? What kind of devices?
Okay. Yeah, the customer that is in a pharmaceutical company, which is worldwide. There are quite a few of them. And they are using a very broad environment of cloud. Cloud being Google, Azure, and Amazon. And they also have an amazing, great in-house cloud based on vSphere and HPE hardware afterwards. So, but they still also have a lot of physical systems from the past. So that's it has to work everywhere, effective. Okay, but you have seen now, it finally got possible to install Chef and run the recipe. It did configure Rear. It set up a weekly cron that you can see here. It even tested if it could mount the NAS location. That was tested automatically. And it set up a backup in the, oops, okay. It did set up the weekly backup for a weekly make backup. That's all automatically done. So this was driven by the file. Oops. Oh. Install. Does it not install? Oh, maybe it's different. It's not there? Okay. Here you can see the complete recipe, what it does. It's quite big. But big. Install the binaries. And then installs the local configuration file. And you can see the local configuration. Oh, I'm not logged in, that's why. I have to log in, of course. I was wondering why I couldn't find the config file. If I log in now into the VirtualBox, okay. And let's become root because I have to delete something. This was the file. OK, Okay, I will edit the file, because for the second demo, I will use this one and just uncomment that one. Yeah. And then we can do the kitchen converge again. I will use another window for that. So this second demo, I commented out the location of the NFS location in the configuration file. That means now it's NA not applicable. That means that we don't want rear to be configured. And let's see what happened. Not much. It only deleted the cron entry, because there is no need to remove the configuration file. And the automatically backup is scheduled, in fact, weekly through a cron entry. So you just have to remove the cron entry, and then we are fine. Okay. Another possibility that I just want to demonstrate is just to remove this file. Okay. File is not there anymore. And just do a converge again and see what happens now. Now it will take the default value, which is inside defined attribute of the cookbook. Okay. And the nice thing about that cookbook will be that you can have a wrap around it, because most chef cookbooks are part of a big collection. That's logically because it's not there. Yeah, I don't know. Ah, yeah. This is a security issue of the Mac. It's not allowed anymore to mount something which is not predefined within the user space. Okay. Please use kitchen logs. Let's see. It's always nice to have a live demo. Huh? This is Chef. Eh? You can really see what happens here. Mount failed to resolve server. Volumes name of service not known. So he took the wrong volume. That's because it was not defined properly in the attribute, probably. It's my fault. It was a test setup. Eh? But okay. But I see you can really learn from it. Eh? You don't break your live system. You're just a test environment that you can test your cookbook until it works. Where am I? The cookbook should be somewhere in here, I think. No, it is not. I put it somewhere else. But okay, doesn't mind. It's not that bad. As you can see, it's a live demo. I won't dig into it because the time is almost finished anyhow. Okay, the cookbook is, let's say, ready for deployment for the 35,000 systems at the customer itself. Here, this is a live demonstration, so if something breaks, it's not the fault of the cookbook itself, it's probably fault of my attribute definition. But okay, that's the game of the live. Huh? If you use live demonstrations, something must break. Otherwise, it's not live. Any questions about the cookbook itself? Should be any interest for it?
You used crons there for the setup of rear. Are you recommending that, or are you somehow have favors for that again? Or are there any like differences between like cron or system D timers if you use rear, or?
Yeah.
Can you still use it?
The question was, in the demonstration we use cron to set up rear on a weekly basis. Is there any reason for it? Not really. That is more or less for the customer that it is done. Okay. In the past, in 2.4, rear was still automatically configured also in cron entry. That in 2.5, that has been removed because we let it up to the customer how he wants to schedule rear, right? Because like you said, systemd can do it these days, but still cron is used a lot, or other possibility like Tidal or Control M is used to trigger rear. So whatever the customer likes, can put in place. Okay, time is up, my friends. I would say have a nice FOSDEM conference and take a sticker. And if you have any questions.